I'd like to add my welcome to you all for coming to this very important meeting today. So I've been charged with giving people who might not be so familiar about mitochondrial diseases, I guess a 101 class on mitochondrial diseases. But what I thought I'd also do is, towards the end of my presentation, is just give you a little bit of a summary about what the AMDF is about in terms of its desire to promote research into mitochondrial diseases, particularly very patient-focused research. So I guess the first question someone might ask is, well, what is a mitochondrion? What are mitochondria? Mitochondrion is the singular for it. And so what we have here is a cartoon of a cell, and people might recognize that as a cell with a nucleus and all the gluggy stuff that's around the nucleus. And within the nucleus, there are these very small structures, which are colored green here, which you may be able to see as green. And these are the mitochondria. And if you blow up the mitochondria into a larger picture, this is what a mitochondrion looks like from a schematic point of view, if you were to look at it under a microscope. And mitochondria are incredibly important components of virtually every cell in the body. There are hundreds to thousands of them in any given cell. And the mitochondria themselves are packed full of proteins that have very important functions. There are probably over 1,000 different proteins that are in mitochondria. Each of them has a very important role. One of the most important roles for mitochondria is the burning of some of the stuff that we eat, so fat and sugar in particular, burning it to make energy in the form of ATP. And every cell in the body needs a constant supply of ATP to be able to work properly. And so the mitochondrion is where the action is as far as that's concerned. So most of the ATP that's generated is made by this set of structures here that together are called the mitochondrial respiratory chain. So it's not surprising if there is a problem in supplying ATP that cells, tissues, organs in the body might run into problem. And so if we look at what are some of the clinical features that we see in individuals who are affected with mitochondrial disease, well, I guess the first catchphrase is any symptom, any organ, any age. And that's literally absolutely correct. And this is a shortish list of the kind of problems that we can see in individuals with mitochondrial disease, ranging from accumulation of a chemical called lactic acid, which is a signature chemical for mitochondrial disease in the newborn period. And often when the disease presents itself as early as the newborn period, it's a very fulminant and severe disease and is usually fatal within the first year or two of life. And you can see from this list here that you can range from having problems involving single organs, so muscle weakness, liver failure, renal disease, diabetes, through to multi-system disease. So sometimes mitochondrial disease will hit an individual multiple times causing multiple organs to work insufficiently. And so you can see here that there is a very wide range of potential problems that can be associated with mitochondrial disease. And surprisingly, or perhaps not so surprisingly, sometimes or often it can be difficult for a medical person to put things together and realize that the person they're seeing may well have a mitochondrial disease. And so one of the jobs of the AMDF is to increase family, community, and also the health community's awareness of mitochondrial disease. Diagnosis of mitochondrial disease, well, you have your clinical suspicion, but then invariably you need to move on, or traditionally we've needed to move on to do a number of investigations. And so I've broken them up. There are sort of first line investigations that are often done that are usually screening type tests in blood and urine. Sometimes a lumbar puncture needs to be done. Often imaging of the brain may be helpful because sometimes we can see very characteristic features on an MRI scan or CT scan of the brain that might point in that direction. But traditionally, at least in the paediatric realm where I live, we, to try and establish a mitochondrial diagnosis, we've had to then move on to more invasive testing. And by that I mean liver and muscle biopsies, which need to be done under a general anaesthetic and so have their own risks associated with that. And we can then take those tissue samples, look at them under the microscope and analyze them for their ability to make ATP. And so that can give us very solid evidence that we're potentially looking at a mitochondrial disorder. And then there are some circumstances where we can, at this point in time, completely bypass the need for that and go straight to a genetic-based test where the clinical picture is so characteristic, it points to a particular gene as being the likely cause. And one good example of that is a disorder called MELAS, mitochondrial encephalopathy, lactic acidosis and stroke-like episodes, very characteristic disorder. And we know that about 80% of people who have MELAS will have a particular genetic change in a particular gene. So if someone has that clinical picture, we can go straight to gene testing. But once we've, even with enzymology, once we've established that there is a functional problem, the real trick then comes to trying to identify which gene is likely to be the cause. And part of the complication is that the mitochondrial respiratory chain, which is this black box here, is built by a complex system of two genetic systems. Everyone is familiar with chromosomes and genes on chromosomes in the nucleus, and we have somewhere between 20 to 25,000 genes, depending on which paper you're reading this day. But we also have a separate genome called the mitochondrial genome, which actually lives inside mitochondria. And that's much smaller, only codes for 37 genes, but each one of those genes is absolutely critical for building the mitochondrial respiratory chain. So when we look at the genetics of mitochondrial diseases, we've got the mitochondrial genome involved, and then there are a bunch of genes that are important for building or making components of the mitochondrial respiratory chain. Then there's another bunch of genes that are important for helping configure the respiratory chain together and maintain its stability. And then there's another bunch of genes on top of that that help, that regulates mitochondrial DNA production and maintenance. And so all up, there are probably in excess of 200 genes that need to be working efficiently together to be able to make a functional respiratory chain. And so if you have a mistake in any one of those genes, you're going to have problems with the respiratory chain. And so genetic diagnosis has been a particularly tricky process up until recently, because often we don't have a clue in terms of which is the gene we should be focusing on. I mentioned sometimes we do, but most of the time we don't. And so the genetic hunt becomes a painstaking one after the other gene screening technology. So to summarize, the respiratory chain disorders can affect any organ and have an onset at any age. In the general scheme of things, they're not that rare from a genetic perspective. About 1 in 5,000 people are affected by mitochondrial disease. That may well be an underestimate, in fact. That's a conservative estimate. And unfortunately, right now, there are very few effective treatments for the mitochondrial disorders. I've mentioned it's a very broad, heterogeneous group of disorders, and at the present time, in the majority of cases, we don't know the underlying genetic basis, and problems can affect, and the gene, one in over 200 genes could potentially be affected. So the really exciting thing that's happened over the last few years has been the development of a technology called next-generation sequencing. And this has really allowed us to be able to screen multiple genes much more efficiently and effectively. In case you're wondering, yes, I am a closet Trekkie. So this next generation sequencing really was born out of the Human Genome Project. So people will have heard of the Human Genome Project. The aim of the Human Genome Project was to sequence every single gene in the body. That was accomplished a couple of years ahead of schedule, but along the way, as people were screening or sequencing the genome, they developed better and better technologies for the sequencing component of that. And so this graph shows what the average cost was to sequence the human genome over the years. And you can see that there's been a really dramatic fall in the cost. You know, the first human genome, we can say, cost about $3 billion. Now, with the latest technology that's become available in Australia as of early this year, you can now sequence the human genome for about $1,000 US, which might be about $2 million Australian by the current exchange rates. So what are the practical advantages of next generation sequencing for mitochondrial disorders? Well, firstly, we're predicting it will facilitate a much more rapid diagnosis with less invasive investigations. Our ideal goal is to demonstrate that identifying someone clinically, having some blood-based screening tests could point you in the right direction, and then based on that you could go straight to DNA-based testing and hopefully in most cases bypass the need to have to do biopsies. That's our ideal. So we think that this will be the case with next-generation sequencing, and a number of us are currently researching in that area to try and prove that. Understanding the genetic basis of the disorder will be really important in helping us improve our understanding of the biology for individuals with this disorder, and we anticipate that it will translate to the development of targeted therapies, so-called precision medicine. That will take time, but right now what establishing a genetic diagnosis means for families is we can provide them with much more accurate genetic counselling, and potentially that will allow families to restore their reproductive confidence, because often with many families, when they have a child with a mitochondrial disorder, they're so scared to have another child with a disorder that they stop having children. So establishing a genetic diagnosis will be very helpful in that regard. So, as I said, right now there are a number of us around the country who are involved in research looking at next generation sequencing technologies for mitochondrial diseases, and hopefully in the next year or two we'll be able to report what we hope we'll find. This is just a slide to show you how next generation sequencing has already impacted on mitochondrial gene discovery. And the different coloured boxes show different approaches that have been used over the years, becoming more sophisticated as time goes by. And the bars in green are the genes that have been identified using next-generation sequencing technologies. And you can see those technologies have really only been available for the last 4 or 5 years. But with those technologies has come a dramatic increase in the number of new mitochondrial genes that are being discovered on a year-by-year basis, including quite a number of new mitochondrial genes that have been discovered here in Australia. So just to finish up, just to tell you a little bit about some of the activities that the AMDF has been involved in from a research perspective. So the AMDF was formed by a group of individuals who had a personal and professional interest in mitochondrial disease. And the specific aims of the AMDF are to foster knowledge about mitochondrial disease, establish a network, a support network for families with mitochondrial disease, and to encourage and facilitate research into mitochondrial disease. And so in terms of the research activities that the AMDF has been particularly keen to support, they include AMDF PhD scholarships. It's getting a bit dry here. And this is aimed at pulling in the best and brightest students, make them passionate about mitochondrial disease with the hope that they'll become the future research leaders. And we've got a few of those people in the audience at the moment. I had to bring some to make the audience bigger. No. The second type of grant that we support are the AMDF incubator grants. And so these are small pots of money that are available for researchers who have a great idea, have some data, but need to build on the data so that they can then become competitive with the larger grant funding bodies like the NHMRC, the UMDF in the US and NIH and other funding bodies. And there have been a number of projects that have been funded along the way as incubator grants. The other grants that are available, this has been an evolving process, and our strategy with regards to what we want to fund has been developing over the last 12 months. So additional entities that we're keen to fund, AMDF Research Equipment Grants, AMDF Translational Research Grants. So the idea here is if there's something that is really clinically relevant, this is an opportunity to fast track it into clinical practice. AMDF Clinical Trial Infrastructure Support Grants. One of the big difficulties in entering into clinical trials for whatever disease is that they're incredibly expensive. And without the involvement of major pharma companies, it's very difficult for independent researchers to fund this. So the AMDF has taken the strategic view that providing infrastructure support in the right kind of clinical setting might help entice some of the overseas pharma companies to look at Australia as a potential place for entering into multi-centre clinical trials. And then other things that we'd like to see develop are training fellowships for post-PhD scientists, training fellowships for clinicians who want to train in mitochondrial diseases. Sometimes research funding is very much focused on an idea that already has some established background to it. But one of the things we don't want to see miss out is this so-called blue sky research. So really brilliant ideas that could be high risk, but which potentially could have high gain. And so that's an area that we want to see being able to fund as the funding pot available to the AMDF builds. And then finally, large equipment grants, where the funding's available for that as well. And just to summarise or finish up by giving you some snapshots of some of the things that have been funded to date. In terms of the PhD scholarships, we've had a number of students who've been involved in mitochondrial gene discovery projects, which have been very successful. We've recently funded a PhD student who's going to look at the consequences of mitochondrial dysfunction on kidney disease associated with diabetes. And we've also recently funded another student who's going to be looking at the relationship between mitochondrial respiratory chain disorders and how fatty acids are broken down. Fatty acids are one of the other sources of energy for the body, and they're very much interrelated. So this potentially could give new inroads into our understanding of the biology of these disorders. In terms of some of the incubator grants that have been recently supported, one is to look at blood-based protein biomarkers to help in the rapid screening and diagnosis of patients with mitochondrial diseases, which we think is very important. A study looking at the kind of expenses that families have that aren't covered by Medicare or their health insurance. So these are particularly focused on individuals or families with chronic diseases, and mitochondrial diseases is one of the diseases being focused here. And then a third project that's just been approved is one to use technology in Melbourne to screen a large cache of drugs and chemicals for their potential usefulness as therapeutic agents in mitochondrial disease. And then finally, we've just approved funding for a trial of an analogue of a coenzyme Q for a particular mitochondrial disorder. So we're excited that that's going to be starting or should be starting in the very near future. So just to summarise, I think next generation sequencing is going to open up fantastic opportunities for more rapid clinical diagnosis. And I really think it's going to change how we practice medicine, not only in terms of mitochondrial disease, but across the board. And the reasons for that are because there'll be a more rapid and efficient diagnosis, we'll have improved genetic counselling, and with an improved understanding of the biology is going to become the opportunity to develop new therapies. And then finally, of course, there've always got to be caveats. There are lots of issues that we still need to face. And you're going to hear about some of those relating to the new technologies that are coming online. And I guess the bottom line is we need to do more research. And on that note, I'll stop and can take any questions if anyone has any.